Most common way that I've personally seen Todokanai Koi translated into is unreachable love. I'm no expert on Japanese or anything, but regardless of the language, this expression of feeling can be flipped around, turning instead into something like a love that cannot reach or a love that cannot be reached. White Album 2 invokes these very feelings within most of the closely knitted cast it possesses, but the main focus falls upon the main trio of Haruki Kitahara, Setsuna Ogiso, and Kazuza Toma. Throughout the 5 years the narrative spans, the three of them experience multiple different forms of Todokanai Koi, sometimes in the form of a confessional song, other times proclaimed within the lobby of Narita Airport, or played even in the booming walls of a performing arts concert hall. Yet, we as the reader know it isn't that simple, because Todokanai Koi isn't just an expression. It is the culmination of feelings bound to its holders, told in song, craving the comfort of resolution, and a feeling of their love reflected back.
Stick it in! No.
So before we get into any of the lyrics, I just want to say that we'll sort of be taking this like lyric by lyric or sometimes phrase by phrase and just kind of pause there and talk about it when it comes up in the song. So the song begins with the question, are you pretending to be lonely? And with that we can assume that the person who's on the receiving end of this song is someone who's hiding themselves, whether it be, say, a true self or just their whole self in its entirety. Applying these different ways of hiding yourself, in the context of White Album 2, we have Setsuna and Kazuza. So, Setsuna hides her true self from the public. She's a girl who loves to sing karaoke for hours on end, oftentimes being quite selfish about it, and is someone who really adores the people who are genuinely close to her. And then we have Kazuza, who hides her whole self. She ignores pretty much everyone around her, and the only time we see her communicating at school is with Haruki in the form of piano accompaniment with Haruki's guitar. Just as it is with the lyrics though, Kazuza is merely pretending to be lonely, whereas with Setsuna, she is lonely by circumstances, instead misunderstood as a school idol of sorts. Throughout some of the extra White Album 2 works that feature Kazuza's point of view, we can see more of her pretending to be lonely. We learn in them that she's always sort of been fascinated with Haruki, and she'd internally comment on his life and how his class reppy attitude affects other people, such as Chikase Hayasaka, which is kind of just like this bro friend sort of person in the VN, but before that they had like a little bit of a feud before Haruki's attitude sort of warmed up to him and they became good friends afterwards. Though the VN and many characters outright say that the song is meant for Kazuza on multiple occasions, I think it's still important to wonder how it can apply to both Kazuza and Setsuna, this being due to when Haruki is sort of internally trying to express what the song means to him. He says, quote, "I have to tell it to her, who turned my cheap lyrics into a great song out of genuine, unnecessary kindness. I have to tell it to her, who will embrace my song and sing it with a voice which I could only dream about," end quote. Moving on from that sort of detour, because that's actually supposed to be for later, the singer almost acts like as if they've received a response, to which they reply with, then we have our singer say, this line lets us know that the singer didn't immediately recognize that they had fallen in love. They maybe garnered an interest in them, started thinking about them more, and then all of a sudden they're like, oh shit, I've fallen in love. Oops, my bad. So then we get into the pre-chorus, which is, the singer says they want their heart to be reflected in the mirror, which is basically them saying they want to receive a form of their love reflected back to them in the mirror from the person that they're singing it to. Problem is that they don't exactly know how to go about this. So the song builds into the main chorus, starts crescendoing until it all explodes and the singer proclaims, the singer believes their love to be unreachable, yet they still hold on to the hope that one day it'll be reflected back towards them, despite the fact that, knowingly, until they receive an answer back, their heart cannot come alive. There are many interpretations to this chorus, and of course when we had Haruki first writing the lyrics, he couldn't have expected how all of this would sort of reflect his own life. More on that later, I won't get into that now, but right now, what I like to see this as is the recipient of the love our singer is trying to transmit towards. It's out of the speaker's reach metaphorically, as they are physically unable to express their feelings. Because as we see in the song, or rather, not see, the singer never once goes up to them and like expresses their feelings towards them. They just immediately come to the conclusion that, oh, my love is unreachable. Following the chorus, our singer has a moment of reflection as they recall, turning momentarily to once again apply this to White Album 2. I find it very interesting sung from Haruki's perspective, considering the way he acts in introductory chapter. He's one of the few people who will actually talk to Kazusa normally, and he's very direct towards her. And taking away Haruki as like a vessel for this song, and only looking at it in the context of just lyrics on a page, this line sort of gives off the impression that this singer had a situation of love at first sight, which is somewhat similar to what Haruki admits way later on in Kazusa Normal, where like the first thing that made him fall in love with Kazusa was something simple. And it was just her looks. I mean, shit, man, I don't blame him. Damn. The song then goes into the next pre-chorus. No, So this pre-chorus bears resemblance to the first one in terms of structure and pretty much everything except for a couple of words. So it's, what should I do to have my heart reflected in the mirror? Versus, now, what should I do to have myself reflected in your heart? So this kind of gives us the answer all the way back then as to what the mirror is. It's the recipient's heart, and then myself, my heart. They sort of line up, but I think this little change is a good way of sort of showcasing that the singer isn't really hiding their intentions anymore, and they're fully aware of what they want now. Going along with this into the main chorus once more, we arrive at tragedy. It is no longer that their love is unreachable, not even that it can't happen, but that it simply will not come true. Yet despite this, they maintain the hope that the day it is reflected will come. As long as that blurred answer will somehow shine through even a little, their love will surely form into something. Then the song shifts to a guitar solo before having a final reprise of the first pre-chorus and chorus, ending the song with the singer's heart unable to come alive. Before getting into that section, though, there's a cool detail I want to point out since I was showing clips of the closing chapter OP, in particular the hands. So if you look closely at the hands, you can actually see that the one on the right has a different fingernail length from both the beginning and end of the OP. This small little detail gives us an answer as to who the owner of the hand is, as people who play classical stringed instruments, or more relevant to this, piano, they generally keep their fingernail length shorter, so they have more control over the instrument. So if we use this fact and apply it to the OP, we can deduce basically that the owner of the right hand is, of course, Kazuza. And if the final scene is of two hands joining together, one of them being Kazuza and the other one assumingly Haruki's, then it's only natural to think that the hands in the beginning of the OP are Haruki's and Setsuna's. Most of this can be figured out without having to look very deeply into the hands, and instead just basing it on the logic of the story, or how the shot of Kazuza extending her hand into the sky is what directly leads into the final scene of the two hands joining together, but I just thought it was cool, and I wanted to point it out, so yeah. Alright, I promise this is the last time we'll be starting a section with Todokanai Koi. Probably. I mean, you are watching an analysis on it. This is also a special mix I made combining both Todokanai Koi piano version and Todokanai Koi Valentine Life, so if you're interested in hearing that separate from this, I'll have a link in the description. But anyways, Todokanai Koi is a pop song with lyrics written by Haruki, the actual song composed by Kazuza, and is sung in performance by Setsuna. In the eyes of Kazuza, it is a song written for Setsuna, a song composed for Setsuna, and a song only for Setsuna. In the eyes of Setsuna, it is a song written for Kazuza, a song composed for Haruki, and a song meant only for Kazuza. In the eyes of Haruki, it is a song written for Kazuza, a song composed by Kazuza, and a song meant for Kazuza, but also for Setsuna, as Haruki hasn't fully sorted out his feelings yet. How the song came about creation is pretty funny, as it all started with Takeya giving Kazuza Haruki's lyrics, and then her going off all on her own and doing her thing. Past that, the rest is history, with preparing a whole new song in only one day with the normal hijinks and all that come with it. You know, for something so important to the core of White Album 2, it really is funny how last-minute everything about this song is, but I guess it's also fitting seeing how the song's existence is the culmination of chance encounters between the three and the people close to them supporting their efforts. And sure, with only two songs, Setsuna would have still gotten the chance to sing her heart out, and Kazuza would have still played in front of other people sharing her joy of music, but Haruki would not have been able to write lyrics, leaving behind his original motive for joining in the first place. Writing something means making yourself vulnerable, let alone writing lyrics to a love-focused pop song. And it is for certain that getting those feelings out is what caused him to make the decisions that changed the trajectories of all their lives. But before that, let's talk about the ancient Greeks for a little bit. Now, I understand that at first this section may seem a little bit out of place, or at the very least, the Greek love portion, but just bear with me for a little bit. The Greeks possessed many different words to describe specific forms of love, and I bring the existence of these words into the picture because I believe there's no definitive catch-all way to describe love, and it certainly isn't shown that way in White Album 2. There is philia, love and friendship, in the form of Haruki's bond with Takia, a friendship where at a time seemed to have been fractured, but never truly lost, as seen in Kazusa Mini Afterstory. There is storge, love and family, paralleled between the different familial situations found at Setsuna and Kazusa, one that is blessed never to lose it, and the other who must build it back. The majority of Kazusa Normal is filled with eros, as they dive deep into a love of depravity. And in one of love's strongest forms, we see agape, a sacrificial love, akin to the actions of Haruki and Kazusa True, who threw away all his relationships and country just to be with the one he loves. Most of these terms are quite outdated, and not necessarily important to White Album 2 in particular, but it acts as a nice way to classify different forms of love in a story riddled with so many different types of it. And yet, even with all these terms, I still find that the Greeks missed out on two, and the ones that I believe are of the most important essence, true love and real love. As such, the definitions are born from what I believe them to be, because everyone has their different meanings for everything. But I ask that you keep my definitions in mind for the rest of the video, as I'll call back to this concept later on. To me, true love is idealistic, something that is not meant to work out, yet does so anyways. It's overwhelming and clouds judgment, leading people to do things that they normally would not do. Real love is realistic, go figure. It is something that is achieved with hard effort and overcomes the struggles it faces because of it. It's strong yet powerful, meaning to forge a bond over time that would stand unbreakable. These definitions will sound familiar to anyone who's read White Album 2, because they describe the two different loves between Haruki and Kazusa and Haruki and Setsuna. In the name of true love, Haruki throws away everything in order to make his love work. In the name of real love, Haruki makes peace with the 5-year turmoil in his heart and chooses the love he made during that time. To be with Kazusa is to choose true love. To be with Setsuna is to choose real love. And it's incredibly ironic that the idealist ending and the realist ending are swapped between the two. Neither of these loves are more powerful than the other, as they stand on equal ground parallel to each other. Yet only one of them faces Todokanai Ikoi initially, the catalyst to the snowfall of emotions that wouldn't see itself fade till many years later. It is only natural to discuss Kazusa's relationship with Todokanai Ikoi first, as the song is most prominently written with her in mind. Mentioned not too long ago in the lyrical analysis portion, I brought up the first line, "Are you pretending to be lonely?" and said it befit Kazusa the most due to her acting like she's uninterested in the people around her, but is secretly observant to Haruki's presence and his impact on others. Haruki himself is also interested, and ponders early on what exactly makes Kazusa tick, longing for a way to find himself reflected in her heart, even if he didn't quite understand it at the time. The second verse lines up with how Haruki first came to fall in love with Kazusa, a love at first sight that was so bright it dazzled in his eyes. It's pretty easy to line up the song with its true meaning in the story, as all you have to do is imagine it as an internal message from Haruki to Kazusa, so I want to instead focus on these different forms of unreachable love inside of the song, and the way it outlines introductory chapter as a whole. We already noted that the first verse is about Haruki taking interest in Kazusa, so there's no need to go over that again. In the pre-chorus, Haruki unknowingly ponders on how he can get Kazusa to reflect his love for her back, but it is a love that cannot reach, as he does not fully realize it yet himself. That is, until the evening after the festival enters the first chorus, where Kazusa finally reflects it back, though unbeknownst to him. So instead, as we see, Setsuna is the one who reflects it, taking control over the song. Both the song and the story enter a brief moment of peace before the verse remembers who the original recipient of their Todokanai Ikoi is. The pre-chorus of Haruki now understands what he truly desires, and in the chorus as Haruki confesses love to Kazusa under the cold winter snow, believing that his love will reach her this time with a direct approach. causes a lament that he was the one whose love hers could no longer reach, declaring it as a love that cannot be reached anymore, as it had already been taken away by Setsuna. Haruki does not accept this. A pre-chorus thought comes to him again once more, and when presented the opportunity of seeing Kazuza one last time, he seizes it in the hope of their love finally reaching each other. It does precisely so, and the two embrace while all would seem well. Yet, that is simply not what is meant to be, for Kazuza is leaving behind her newly reinvigorated life in favor of another that possesses her dream of music. And so, we enter the final chorus of the story, as Kazuza and Haruki embrace in the loud halls of Narita Airport, declaring their unreachable love to the worlds with hearts that can no longer come alive, before fading quietly into the falling snow of Dalsenyo Alcoda. Setsuna's place in the song is a little bit more complicated, since it wasn't initially conceived with her in mind. Nevertheless, she plays an equally important part in it all, first taking the stage as an observer. During introductory chapter, Setsuna understands Todokanai Ikoi more than anyone else, as a confession of love to the unreachable Kazuza. As flawlessly the Setsuna performed only a day after first being given the material, she struggled quite a lot in the beginning, claiming there was something stopping her from making the song her own. An oblivious Kazuza doesn't quite understand it, simply writing it off as lyrics for lyrics' sake, or is perhaps trying to avoid confronting the true meaning behind the song. In the attempt of knocking two birds with one stone, Setsuna tells Kazuza that she would only be able to sing the song with all her heart if she knew that the feelings it carries may one day finally reach. Her awareness of the song leads her to finally ask why Kazuza desires to remain lonely, to which she replies the fear of losing a relationship after it is made. Thus, Setsuna's attempt at bringing out the truth ends in failure, unable to make Kazuza accept the feelings she's receiving, as the feelings she harbors in her own heart begin to fester, for she sees Kazuza's lack of a response as a formal decline to Setsuna's declaration of war! The solution she goes with to sing the song is to do so while thinking about Kazuza from Haruki's perspective. Deeming Haruki and Kazuza's love to be unreachable, she prepares to face him with the resolve of confessing, only to see Kazuza doing the exact same thing to a dormant Haruki. Rapid thoughts flood her mind, those of a path where neither of their loves were ever reached, a path where they would always remain the best of friends while still having the same feelings for the same person. Setsuna snaps back to reality, saying in her head that she is able to give up on love in favor of supporting her best friend, but it's simply not possible to keep yourself calm when love is involved. She starts to blame Kazuza for lying about her true feelings and allowing her own to continue developing, yet still come back around with that previously denied love, albeit to an unaware Haruki. In all this frustration and confusion does Setsuna find the resolve she needed, using the belief that this is the only way they may all stay together, before confessing to a now awoken Haruki with her newly awakened love. Though the feelings between the two were strong, the feelings of unreachable love between Haruki and Kazuza were simply stronger, only bolstered by the news of Kazuza's departure from Japan. In this one last act of passion between the two, shown in the lobby of Narita Airport, does Setsuna finally realize the futility of her actions, and embraces the cold freeze of a love that cannot reach, now claiming it for her own.
届かない。私のこの思いは二度と届かない。だからこの歌はもう私の歌。本当に自分のものになってしまった。ねえ、カズサ、ハルキ君、私今なら完璧に歌えるよ。 自分の気持ちを伝える歌として、この、もう届かない恋の歌を。
Taking a brief break from the main trio, I want to focus a little bit on Io and Takia. In the midst of conflict between Haruki and Setsuna's love life during their years of college, do the two of them pick people to support? Takia with Haruki and Io with Setsuna. Both only want what is best for the two, but it also creates a todokanai koi between themselves. Never often do they have the time to consider their own relationship, instead putting focus on mending the fractured one between Haruki and Setsuna. Takia is much more personal about it, being on Haruki's side no matter what until the absolute last straw. Io is more emotional about it, sometimes alternating sides depending on what she deems is the one and the right. This discrepancy in how they approach Haruki and Setsuna's relationship casts a reflection on their own. Takia is a very confident man, claiming to understand women in relationships, yet is unable to convey his feelings to the one he truly loves. Io is a very confident woman, but is more focused on her friend's love rather than her own love, often disregarding and even making fun of Takia's attempts despite understanding his intentions. This is our third todokanai koi, one not born of miscommunication or distance, but instead circumstance. After all, how could you focus on your own relationship when trying to mend that of others? So throughout all of introductory chapter, closing chapter, and the majority of coda, their love remains unreachable, waiting for when the time is ripe to bloom. The return of Kazusa places another wedge in between focusing on themselves, but it is Haruki's choice that ultimately decides their fate. In both Kazusa Normal, including To You, My Sworn Enemy, and Setsuna True, Takia and Io end up together, even considering a child early on in the latter. In Kazusa True, they still remain the best of friends, but Takia starts dating an unnamed girl. This could be seen as yet another one of the sacrifices made for Haruki's happy ending with Kazusa, but I don't think it's smart to make it all about him. Takia's view on love was changed forever by Haruki's resolve to throw away everything, a love of 5 years and friendships of longer, just to be with one person. Lost in the confusion, and after seeing Setsuna's love unable to reach Haruki's even after so long, he gives up on his own. It is impossible to say which outcome provides the two with more happiness, as we rarely see their internal thoughts. But in both true endings do the five still remain together, looking back fondly on those days at Hojo High School. On the campus of Hojo University in the cold winter of Japan, this todokanai koi invade every corner of space, acting as a way of haunting those behind its creation. Even though Setsuna claims she can now sing the song perfectly, hearing it over and over again has now completely inhibited her ability to sing, for when listening to it now, all that would come to her mind was the sound of a keyboard playing and the name Kazusa Toma. Still, this conflict in her heart would not be enough to stop Setsuna from her love of singing, hoping for the day where she could finally set herself free with the song. In the meantime, both her and Haruki encounter reflections of that day, and of themselves. Koharu Sugiura is a reflection of Haruki, as many people already call her Mini Haruki. However, it goes much further than their self-sacrificial and workaholic personalities, because the main source of her roots conflict is another todokanai koi. Mihoko Yada is in love with Haruki, but it is a love that does not reach him. If we place her best friend Koharu in the same equation as the main trio, she becomes a Kazusa, the second one to confess their love and ultimately the one Haruki ends up loving, this equation being based off of introductory chapter's plot. Unlike the main trio, Mihoko and Koharu make up, overcoming what they could not, that is until Setsuna True. Mari Kazuoka is a reflection of Kazusa, focusing on her passion at the cost of love. Haruki's fractured love does reach her at first, before it all spirals down and she leaves in the pursuit of passion, just as Kazusa did 3 years ago. Resolved to not have a repeat of before, Haruki makes sure his reinvigorated love still reaches, and throws away his life in Japan in exchange for one in America, much like Kazusa True. Then we have Chiaki, who is not a reflection, but rather a confrontation of Haruki and Setsuna's past. She's the one responsible for spreading the song around the university, and has been studying their lives since long before that fateful festival day. No more does this all culminate towards than when she sings Todokanai Koi in front of the two, unaware of the unreachable feelings she harbors in her own heart. During all of these routes, an even bigger Todokanai Koi than all before fails to reach, as Setsuna is rejected time and time again, feeling the same sorrow Haruki did on that day 3 years ago. Setsuna's closing chapter, Root. She finally receives the chance she desired to set her feelings free by singing Todokanai Koi, though not of her own choice. The fear of being put in the spotlight to sing overwhelms her at first, so it's up to Haruki to change Todokanai Koi from a song of sorrow into a song of healing. Guiding her with his guitar, Setsuna reawakens from her slumber as a singer, prepared to face whatever lies ahead in their relationship and healthily claiming the song as her own. Would that be all well and good, were it not for the existence of Koda and the reintroduction of Kazusa, the original owner. The usage of the song returns, first as one of healing lovers, and the other to mend 5 years of broken friendships. In Kazusa Normal, it is a lullaby sung by Setsuna in order to mend a broken Haruki. In Setsuna True, it returns to its real, true self. A song with lyrics by Haruki, melody by Kazusa, and sung by Setsuna, reawakening from just being sung to accompanied by guitar and finally piano. Todokanai Koi is no longer just a song of unreachable love, something only shared in the ashes of sadness, but finally belonging to the three of them together as a memory of their bright, effervescent past. Before ending this, I want to quickly go over some of the more meta connections this song has with the rest of the soundtrack, but the majority of them I won't go too deep into as this is ultimately about Todokanai Koi. First is the iconic piano track Kotoba ni Dekinai Omoi, which roughly translates to thoughts or feelings that cannot be conveyed. Todokanai Koi is a song about a person who can't properly convey their love and get it to reach, so the two fit perfectly together. After all, Suzuru Omoi is the White Album 2 insert song, playing over some of the most pivotal moments in the entire VN. This acts as almost a sequel to Todokanai Koi, a song about a person's reflection into the love they once had. Even if the words of theirs do not reach, they will continue to believe and sing them. Twinkle Snow is another story of unreachable love, sung by a girl who recently parted with the one she loved. Ultimately, even if her love would fail to reach them, she would still resolve to grow into an even better self. Shiawasen Akiyoku tells of a person who can't get over a love they lost, attempting to forget their memories of happiness. They understand that it is impossible for them to go back to the days where the two could see each other, but are unable to forget because they still hold the inkling of hope that perhaps one day, they will see each other again. You can see a trend in all the vocal songs so far, telling the futures of Todokanai Koi at different points in time. Yasashi Uso is about someone moving on from a love that they promised would never leave them. A gentle lie was spoken that should they be reborn, they would be together till death. Yet, they found someone else to love, and even though their lover lied, they still want them to be happy as they slowly fix their own wounded heart. Another follow-up to Todokanai Koi, where one of them found another love while away from each other. Aisuru Kokoro is the first happy ED, and doesn't really feel too much like a follow-up to Todokanai Koi, as their loving hearts become one and they walk different paths to the same future. Kokoro wa Itsumo Anata no Soba ni delves right back into the gloom, talking about a love that cannot be reached but will still be felt even while they are apart. And finally, the last two. First up is Toki no Maho, which goes back into the happiness of Aisuru Kokoro, a song being sung for an unreachable love finally being reached thanks to the magic of time. One thing I would like to point out that's special about this song compared to all the rest is that this is, much like Todokanai Koi, an in-universe song that was made in a very similar fashion, which makes it have a very special connection to the song, just like the final vocal theme. Closing is a bit more complicated, and what I consider to be the true follow-up to Todokanai Koi. I believe this to be because it is sung from the perspective of the one being sung towards in Todokanai Koi. Even though the original singer has now moved on at this point, the original recipient is still clinging to them, despite the recipient being the one who pushed them away in the first place. It's impossible for them to control their feelings anymore, so now the recipient becomes the sender. The real person inside of her is waiting. And yet, when the two finally meet in their fated season, she doesn't want them to touch, for as happy as it makes her heart ache even more. She doesn't want to let go, she doesn't want to be apart, but she had already given up, so it's unfair to fall in love again. All she really needs is for him to be by her side. It's time for the real her inside to start moving forward. The fated season comes by once again, and that all the things she's hurt will never come back, she doesn't want to let go. She doesn't want to be apart. She refuses to give up on her love, even if it means hurting him, because it's impossible for her to lie to herself anymore. She needs to find the part of her that can smile and talk with him, and for him to stay with her, saying that he will never leave her alone again. With her clinging to the past, she is sure that if she never faces those feelings from that fateful day, she will never be able to move on. She doesn't want to let him go. She doesn't want to ever be apart. The one wish she has is that she can say how much she loves him, even if she can't admit it. For the majority of song discussion, I've refrained from using gendered pronouns because I believe it's important to acknowledge that music can be applied to many types of people for a variety of different reasons. With closing, however, the song is so blatantly Kazuza that I could not refrain from talking about it without her in mind. Closing, and Kazuza True as a whole, is the ultimate response to Todokanai Koi, crying out loud that she hears his words, that his love will reach, and that she will finally accept those feelings after so long, claiming the song back for her own one last time. Something I absolutely adore about White Album 2 is the fact that there are two true endings. Kazuza's is not the correct ending, and neither is Setsuna's. Both of them stand on equal ground as two forms of Todokanai Koi finally reaching. True love or real love, they are both equally powerful and no one can say otherwise. In my eyes, personal preference of which girl you favor more is bound to what love you idealize the most. Those that favor true love are enticed by how it's never meant to work in the real world, how it's problematic, messy, and difficult to understand. Those that favor real love are enticed by the hard work you must put in for it, winning over the years and working through it with the one you love. Even with these two classifications, there exists one even further out that encompasses both. Full love. Full love is everything. All the good and the bad, the hard and the soft, the loud and the quiet. It oozes from the three of them, a testament to how much they love each other. For as the winter and snow from Toma and Setsuna flow in the frigid breeze, so too do they go to the spring from Haruki, no longer frozen in the season of White Album, and stuck in the depths of unreachable love.